No. Keep playing, guys.
I lost my pick.
Okay, let's play it.
What size do you like?
Sorry, it's gone.
Break Baseball, baseball.
Hey, ladies, say hi. Jen. Hey, ladies. Hi. Okay.
The line has begun somewhere.
Everyone? Sorry about that. Here's another new one, so that I hope you all can join in your hearts of worship, and soon you know it, please sing out. Life laid down, crucified, arms stretched out and open wide. Rescue me so I can be a child of God.
Slaves of the flesh. Don't deal with your flesh. Don't be slaves because you're slaves of God now. Your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. You are not your own, but you're God's. And we read in 2 Corinthians in the next book that Paul wrote to the same church, 2 Corinthians 5, it says, those in Christ no longer live for themselves but for Christ. You are not your own. We do not belong to ourselves. We see wonderful examples of this. We see the life of Paul. We see how, if you read the study his epistles, we read and we find out that Paul's life was, he was beaten, he was in prison, he was stoned, he was lost at sea, he was sick, he was persecuted greatly. He didn't have a glorious life, did he? But he counted for God. He looked at God and said, hey, you know what? I'm adopted in the family of God, and hey, you know what? Christ paid a ransom for my life, and I owe it to him. He bought me, and I'm his. He bought me with what? His blood, didn't he? We go further back in the Old Testament. We see a wonderful picture of Noah and how he builds the ark. He builds the ark in virtually dry area, dry ground. In the middle of just a dry piece of land, and people are making fun of him and laughing at him. But he spends his time, his energy, his resources, because he understands that he belongs to God. That his time here on earth, that his hands, his resources, his tools belong to the Lord. And he builds an ark, and as a result, we find out that it's a preservation of mankind, isn't it? So we see another example of when Christ starts out his ministry, and he begins to handpick his disciples. And he comes along, and he walks along, and he sees Matthew, and he says, Matthew, get up and follow me. He virtually says that, and Scripture has no indication of Matthew even raising an eyebrow. He just gets up and leaves. He didn't even say, Christ, I want to go with you, but just give me 5 minutes, let me finish up my tax duties here and send him off with this with a partner here, and we'll send him to Rome, and then I'll be with you. No, he gets up and he leaves. Because why? Because he understood that he did not belong to himself, but he belonged to God. And we see that the woman who breaks open the expensive perfume and washes the Lord's feet with it. And we know the story that Judas scoffs at that and says, bless the years, wait, did you just waste that? Why did the woman know that? Because she understood that not only her possessions, also that she belonged to God, that she was going to break that expensive perfume open and apply it to the dirty feet of the Lord Jesus. We see a wonderful picture here. And the last picture here that I want to point out is Lord Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, right before his crucifixion. What does the Lord pray? He says, Lord, if there's any way, take this cup from me. Take your wrath from me. I don't want to do this. And then if Scripture cuts off right there, then I'd go, wait a minute, what's going on? But it doesn't. What does it say next? It says, not mine, but your will be done. Doesn't it? Because why? Because the Lord is a perfect example for us, the perfect example for us to understand that he understood that he did not belong to himself. He wasn't there for his own agenda, his own priorities. He was there for God. He was there for us. He understood that. And then we can learn from that this morning, that we need to understand that we're here for God, that we're here for God because we're bought by God. And when you go to the supermarket, or you go to the Walmart, whatever, and you buy something, you expect to have it, don't you? Well, it's very practical here, and it's more practical than we might think it is that when God says, I bought you at a price, you are not your own, but you're mine, then we are to take that and say, hey, well, there's some things here that I need to reevaluate my life. I need to understand that my life is dedicated to the Lord. And we see that I would be afraid that some people in the past, and even now in Emmaus, would come to Emmaus with the attitude and go, well, I'll give God a year of my life. I'll study Scriptures intently. I'll serve him and do what I can. I'll go to church every Sunday. I'll pray. I'll fellowship and stuff. And then after that, I'm going to go to college, or I'm going to go and I'm going to pursue my career, and then because I serve my time. And it doesn't work that way. And so you might say, Jeff, are you telling me that what it means to be a Christian is that everything about me, every part of my being, every second of my life should be for the Lord? And I'm here to tell you, yes, that's what I'm saying. That Scriptures tell us, and that we're exhorted, we're encouraged to live lives that are holy, that are a temple of the Lord, that we are instruments of His peace. And we see that. What's the greatest commandment? What is the greatest commandment that the Lord Jesus identified? It says, to love the Lord your God with what? All your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. Not just on Sundays, or not just a year at Emmaus, or not just a little piece of my tithe right here of what I earned. With all my heart, all my soul, and all my mind. We need to be encouraged this morning that as Christians, that when we leave here and we go on with the rest of our lives, that it's not over. In fact, it's just beginning. And we see, we go back that we need to be bold to pray the prayer that the Lord Jesus prayed. You say, not my will, but your will be done. I prayed that prayer 3 times in my life. First time I prayed it was when I got out of high school, a few years ago. And I prayed that, Lord, not your will, but mine. Not my will, but your will be done. And the next thing I knew, I was in a room full of 45 middle school kids giving them the gospel. And then it turned out that was part of the ministry of my service, that I was serving the Lord for 3 years. I did that. But the next time I prayed that prayer, Lord, not mine, but your will be done. And then I met my wife. Praise the Lord. Then the next time, the third time I prayed it, Lord, not my will, but yours be done. And where do you think I ended up? Dubuque, Iowa. Dubuque, Iowa. I left the promised land for Dubuque, Iowa. I'm just kidding. But I'm sure you get my point this morning. Let us be encouraged that it's not easy, and I understand that. It's not easy, and it's not any easier out there. Trust me. But the Lord calls us to understand that we are not our own. We belong to Him. Let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning, and we thank you for your Son, Lord Jesus, Lord, that we can come boldly before the throne, that we're adopted in the family of God. And Lord, help us to understand that we are not our own, but we belong to you, Lord, that we are instruments of your peace, that we are temples of your Spirit, and that needs to dictate of what we need to do with our lives and how we need to run our lives. Lord, you don't ask us to give up our dreams and fun, the fun in life, but you ask us that we give our lives to you as a token of appreciation. Let's be those instruments. Let's be those people that understand that we do not belong to ourselves, but we belong to God. We are bought at a price that you expect to have us. We send you great amen.
Jack, another couple quick announcements that we just missed. First is that 10 o'clock tonight, Classroom D, there will be many people that are interested. Help me out over at Hillcrest. No.
Big crowd tonight. Looks like there's no spots in the bleachers.
Yeah. Sure, we know. And Mr. Leader, bring him back on court.
Yellow.
Red and yellow.
back end.
17.
I've seen like a million, but
what year are you?
Especially.
Oh, you did the right thing.
Continuing that.
You just think
the biggest one, though, is that.
What's continuing education?
Take whatever you want.
After you get a degree,
you can take whatever you want. Take. Okay. Have a seat.
Who does not have anything?
Beth, what are you registered as?
One year.
Okay.
I'm sorry, do you know what
I'm doing? That's probably the one they have for you anyway.
After you use yours, can we look at mine?
You already did that. So you need...
Now, there is one class schedule.
Take the blue sheet if you are a sophomore, please. Sophomores only.
A junior, yes, that is the junior form.
Junior form?
Hang on.
Oh, I'm sorry.
If you are six, who's senior?
Oh, that's right.
Senior?
That's
John Grant.
Yes, you are?
She caught me in more senior.
Which did you take then? Which other theology did you take? Okay, but then you have another requirement somewhere, right? You have, it just says doctrine somewhere in here.
Thank you.
hi, yip yip.
Wow.
I know, that's how you do it.
guys or what?
Stop it! Stop!
Exercising.
Bernie Roy. In the middle, starting at center, a 6'6 sophomore from Auburn, Iowa, number 44, Chad Roy. Starting at guard, a 5'10 junior from Ankeny, Iowa, number 22, Kyle. At guard, a 6-foot senior from Kingland, Kansas, number 34, Tim O'Brien.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. they're recording what we're saying.
Go left, go left.
Come on, Jenna.
Bonavilla.
Hold me back. Yeah. Chances I'm sat here in the last shirt.
Does she ever shoot? Does she not shoot or just doesn't make them?
Huh?
Does she shoot and misses them?
No, like, okay.
Oh, she won't shoot?
Yeah, and she has like so many chances, but she'll just keep passing it back and forth.
Yeah.
Like those two.